A very good morning to all and wish you all a very, very happy new year. On the front page today we have Finance Minister unveils plans for 102 lakh crore infra projects. So Union Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman has outlined these plans for infrastructure project investments by 2024-25. So the center, state and private sector will share the capital expenditure in the ratio 39:9, 39:22. Means central government will be putting in 39% of this, state government 39%, and remaining 22% will come from the private sector. So this is a significant increase over the last 6 years when the center and the states together have spent 51 lakh crores on infra projects. So here you can see the breakup of the expenditure on select sectors is also provided here. Like energy will take in 24%, urban areas 16%, railways 13%, roads 19%, then others are irrigation, rural infrastructure, social infrastructure, communication and others. So this is there. Then here you have core sector output shrank 1.5% in November. So for the month of November 2019-2, the data which has come forth shows that the output of 8 core infrastructure sectors contracted. Means it was, growth was in the negative at minus 1.5%. So you should know the 8 core sectors too. These are coal, crude oil, natural gas, steel, electricity, cement, etc. So you know, refinery products, fertilizers. Then you have rail travel to turn dearer from today. So train travel is set to cost more from the new year onwards. Railways has increased fares for passenger trains by up to 4 paise per kilometer. So here is the news regarding that. The fares for ordinary non-AC trains will be increased by 1 paise per kilometer and for mail or express non-AC classes by 2 paise per kilometer. For AC, it will be 4 paise per kilometer. But suburban fares and season tickets charges remain unchanged. So it's for long distance. Then below you have Indore Jamshedpur leads Swachh 2020 table. So for 2020, the Swachh Sarvekshan, which has been undertaken, sees Indore at the top spot and Kolkata at the bottom. So Indore and Jamshedpur have topped this for 2 consecutive quarters now. So these are cities, this is the list of cities with over 10 lakh population, where Indore tops and Jamshedpur tops in cities with 1 lakh to 10 lakh population. Kolkata remains at the bottom of the ranking of 49 major cities across both quarters. And West Bengal, the reason being that West Bengal did not participate in this exercise, means West Bengal did not provide data. So Kolkata is at the bottom in the list. So this is there. Here you can see first quarter and second quarter, the top 5 urban local bodies with more than 10 lakh population. So here you can see there's Indore and then comes Bhopal, Surat, Nashik and Rajkot. For first quarter, second quarter also Indore, Rajkot, Navi Mumbai, Vadodara and Bhopal. On page 6 you have Odisha tribals still suffering from hunger, malnutrition. So food security programs here are not existing. It has not reached here is what the social activists are saying. So there have been deaths of 20 infants in the Juanga tribe at Nagada village in Jaipur district in Odisha in 2016. So here you can see right to food campaigners have started visiting villages inhabited by these particularly vulnerable tribal groups in different parts of the state now. So this right to food campaign is a platform of social activists and they are campaigning here and they say that government welfare programs have not reached here and the marginalized tribals here are in the backward pockets of Odisha still suffer from hunger and malnutrition. On page 7 you have Bhima Koregaon village prepares for historic day. So every year at the start of the new year on 1st Jan, there are celebrations here in Bhima Koregaon village near Pune. So here again this year too security has been beefed up because in 2018 when it was the 200th year as such, 200th anniversary of Bhima Koregaon battle of 1818, it had seen violence here amongst the Bhima Koregaons. These are the scheduled castes who had been no who had a clash with the upper castes, the Marathas here. So this had resulted in the problem been rising further. The social activists who were present with the Bhima Koregaon members as such here, they were targeted as urban nixals, and so this situation had escalated. There were cases filed against them. So this actually Bhima Koregaon war is battle in which the Marathas were defeated by the Britishers, and the Britishers were assisted in this war, had taken the service in this war of the Bhima Koregaon villagers here or from scheduled castes. So this is a caste trouble. So they had seen how in this war their soldiers had bravely fought against the Marathas, but the Marathas see it as celebration of their defeat in that war. So that's the problem. But then this is a monument also erected here to dedicate it to the soldiers who fought in this war. So this is there. Now it is the 202nd anniversary of Bhima Koregaon battle, and security has been beefed up here because lakhs are expected to congregate here for celebrations. Then below you have Gujarat Congress alleges crop insurance scam. So here Congress in Gujarat is alleging that the farmers in two Junagadh villages were paid 80 to 90% less in claim amount. So it is said they were paid only around 1.45 and 8.19% of the claim which they were entitled to. So around 91.54 to 90.43% of the claim amount which they were entitled to was not paid. So they claim that if we look at the scam in settling crop insurance claims in Gujarat in the last 5 years, it is the biggest such scam in the history of the state. It is also true that earlier scores of BJP leaders, including party MPs and even Chief Minister Vijay Rupani, has accused crop insurance companies of shortchanging farmers while settling their crop insurance claims. On page 9, you have 1/5 of country's forests prone to fire. So around 21.4% of forest cover in India is prone to fires. This is what a study by Forest Survey of India has found in its report in 2019. The study has been undertaken from 2004 to 2017. And it is seen northeastern region and central India are the most vulnerable. So here you can see the map also showing the most vulnerable regions and the fire prone regions. Below you have Chandrayaan 3 launched this year. So India will be launching Chandrayaan 3 now. We have seen Chandrayaan 2, which attempted to launch a lander and a rover on moon's surface. Did not succeed because the lander actually did not land smoothly. It was not a soft landing. It crashed and the rover could not come out. So you should be able to recollect the lander was called Vikram and the rover inside it was Pragyan. But Vikram crash landed. So now Chandrayaan 3 is being planned. Chandrayaan 1 mission as such was only an orbiter. Chandrayaan 2, the orbiter is still functioning, but the lander and rover have not, that attempt was not successful. That aspect was not successful. Now Chandrayaan 3 will be launched in 2020 is what has been announced. And it would cost less than Chandrayaan 2. And here you have Supreme Court bats against transfer of community resources. So government has no right to transfer invaluable community resources like village water ponds to a few powerful people and industrialists for commercialization of the property, when many areas in the country perennially face water crisis and access to drinking water is inadequate. So this is what the Supreme Court has ruled. In this case, it says it is essential to safeguard Article 21 of the Constitution, which is right to life. So protection of village commons is essential under Article 21. On the editorial page, the first editorial is a group of theocracies. So this is regarding Organization of Islamic Cooperation, which is a 57 member grouping of Islamic countries. And presently it is planning to have a session on Kashmir and Citizenship Amendment Act. So this editorial says that India must rebuff attempts by OIC to interfere in its internal affairs. So they know they don't have a right to speak on on developments within the country. And this is in the grip of terror. So this is regarding Islamist terror groups, how they pose a threat not just to Somalia but to the entire region in Africa. So we have seen about recent attacks in African countries. So these are Al-Qaeda linked terrorist group Al-Shabaab, which is prominent in Somalia, in its capital Mogadishu, where bomb attack killed at least 79 people and injured 149. The lead article is, it is everybody's constitution. So the conversation that Citizenship Act protests have evoked about the constitution must be taken further, is what this article is trying to say, that how Citizenship Amendment Act conflicts with the constitutional provisions. So to uphold the constitution is important. And this is weighing in on the public sector privatization debate. So they said there is a justification in selling loss-making units. As such, PSUs, loss-making PSUs are being sold off, privatization is happening. But the situation is more nuanced in cases of profit-making entities. So we had seen recently BPCL, Bharat Petroleum Corporation Limited, which is a profit-making PSU, making handsome profits, which has been sold off. So this has been approved. So questions have been raised here that why profit making PSUs are being sold off and loss making PSU, like we had in news yesterday too, that Air India makes 20 crore losses every day. So if BPCL is making profits, that makes up for the loss making PSUs which are not being able to sold off, and why these profit making PSUs should be sold off right now to the private sector when they give profits to the government. So questions have been raised. Then on the op-ed page, you have an anatomy of anti-CAA protests. So this is regarding countrywide agitations going on against the Citizenship Amendment Act. And it says this shows how Indians are now mobilizing against BJP's Hindutva project. And here you have when hospitals become a theater of police brutality. So this is an incident in Mangaluru which took place. So here you can see. We have seen police storming the library of Jamia Millia Islamia University recently in the CAA protests case. And now Karnataka police abused its power by getting inside a hospital in Mangaluru. And this is an even more dangerous precedent, it is said. Police barging into hospitals. We have seen police barging into universities and now into hospitals. Then on page 12, you have this news regarding Army Chief General Bipin Rawat, who has now retired as Army Chief, who has been appointed as the Chief of Defence Staff, and he will be chairing the Department of Military Affairs, which has been created in the Defence Ministry. So Defence Ministry is under its administration, the Department of Military Affairs would function, and Chief of Defence Staff would be the Integrated Chief of Army, Navy and Air Force. And this is regarding front page also, there's this coverage. NPR trial form gets government nod for rollout. So this is regarding National Population Register form, which will be used at a trial stage in September, has been used at a trial stage in September 2019, which seeks detail of birth of father, birth date of mother, place of birth of father and mother. So this is being finalized as the final NPR form. On page 13, you have China welcomes decision to include Huawei in 5G trial. So we have seen this news yesterday that 5G trial will begin in India, and Huawei, the Chinese telecom major, will also be participating in these trials. But we should know that USA has been opposing it. So there has been opposition from USA and Japan against Huawei. USA says that it is a Chinese private sector company, but it is linked to the Chinese government and it would be used for espionage. So it should not be included in 5G projects in any country. And USA has been putting pressure on other countries also to exclude Huawei, including on India. But India, when it announced its 5G trials, it has included Huawei also. So Huawei already has a presence in the country. And here you can see, this is, I regret NJAC verdict. So this is former Supreme Court Judge Justice Kurian Joseph, who has said he regrets his decision causing the NJAC. that is National Judicial Appointments Commission. So this was established by the government. There was NJAC Act passed. Even the constitution as such was amended. It was the 99th Constitution Amendment Act which introduced NJAC to replace the collegium system in the judicial appointments to constitutional courts. But this NJAC was struck unconstitutional by the Supreme Court, stating that it is taking away the independence of the judiciary. So actually in the NJAC appointments would take place, appointments and transfers of judges would take place through it rather than through collegium system of the Supreme Court, and NJAC would have 50-50 members from the government and from the judicial side. So this equal number of presentation was not to the liking of judiciary, and it said that judicial independence would be affected, and it struck down NJAC. But this former judge who was part of this bench who gave this judgment on NJAC says he regrets that decision, seeing the things now, because judicial appointments have been delayed and the problems have been faced in appointments. The government does not make appointments presently. It sits on appointments, and every judge, every CJI has raised concerns regarding appointments. On international page, you have protesters attack US embassy in Iraq. So supporters of Shia militias have breached the outer walls of the compound chanting death to America, and they have attacked the US embassy in Iraq. So protests have been going on in Iraq for over for quite some time now, and this was the first time in years that protesters have been able to reach the US embassy, which is sheltered behind a series of checkpoints in the high security green zone in Iraq. And this is Taiwan passes law to combat China influence. So this is a law which has been passed by Taiwan, which aims at curtailing Beijing's impact on the island's politics. So it's called anti-infiltration bill, which has been passed by Taiwan, which is a small island nation which is not recognized as a nation by many countries, and China claims Taiwan to be part of its own nation under one China policy. And this is China-US will sign phase 1 of trade deal on Jan 15. So US President Donald Trump has announced that phase 1 of the trade deal with China would be signed at the White House. But still there is considerable confusion about the details of the agreement as such. And this is regarding Al-Shabaab claiming responsibility for the deadly bombings in Somalia. We have seen this in the editorial too presently. So the bombings in which at least 79 people were killed last week, Al-Shabaab, which is an Islamist group linked to Al-Qaeda in Somalia, has claimed responsibility for it. On business page, you have current account deficit narrows to 0.9% of GDP. So current account deficit means the difference between imports and exports and such in crude terms. So the current account deficit has contracted presently to 0.9% for the quarter, September 2019 quarter as such. So this is because of lower trade deficit. So trade deficit is basically imports minus exports. Current account deficit includes trade deficit plus, and total deficit is current plus capital account deficit. So current account deficit means remittances also included within it, not just trade in goods. So here you can see the balance of payment and net inflows details are provided here. So it has narrowed presently. And this is fiscal deficit hits 115% of budget estimates till November. So here you can see the fiscal deficit is at 114.8%. So we have already breached the fiscal deficit target. So that is highlighted here. So it stands at 8.07 lakh crores for 2019-20 financial year so far. So fiscal deficit is basically the total borrowing requirements of the government. So the budget is balanced means receipts and expenses. Receipts and expenditure have to be balanced. When the receipts are not sufficient to take care of the expenditure, then you have a deficit, and this fiscal deficit is taken care of through borrowings. Below you have telecom department to approach finance ministry, seek relief for sector. So this is second time in 6 months that Department of Telecom will broach on the subject, because telecom sector is suffering due to huge losses. And there's a need for relief to be provided to the sector. And now for the second time, Finance Ministry would be approached. Earlier in August 2019 also, the reduction in the license fee requirement was pitched for. 36,000 crores, that is the accumulated input tax credit due to the telecom sector, that should be adjusted against the statutory levies is a request being made to. It is said telecom sector is under a debt of about 7 lakh crores and presently 5G trials are beginning. So there are concerns which are being put forth. So that is it. These are the important headlines. The last page are sports related news. For detailed coverage of current affairs, you can visit our website asia.com. Thank you.